toisin näitä tärkeäharrastajia on kysynyt, että päivä on ollut silloin kulttuuripoliittisessa,
että
järjestelmällä puolen tunnin henkilökohtaa haastattelua.
And right, sir, we have it. Well, hello again. You remember me? I was here just a few minutes ago. First of all, ladies and gentlemen, it's great to be back in Finland again. It's been something like 20 years since I was here last. Incredible, but it is still the same country, strange sun and strange dark periods and whatnot, but that's the way you've always done it, so I suppose you should continue doing that. I apologize, first of all, there is a language barrier here. I am very edified to know that most people all through the rest of the world are now speaking English, which is a great relief to me, and I'm able to perform for audiences everywhere and be understood in my language. So I rather apologize for not being able to address you in your language, but if you have any problems, you'll come after and you can ask me questions about things I said, and I hope you don't all come, but some of you would be very welcome. Now, one thing that was not mentioned in the introduction was that I have the great privilege of announcing that I have an asteroid named after me. This is an asteroid that was named after me in 1996, and it's called Randi, appropriately. And it's rather a distinct honor. I had the privilege, some years ago when this happened, the privilege of calling my good friend Arthur C. Clarke in Sri Lanka, who has now left us, unfortunately. And I announced to him, Arthur, I've had an asteroid named after me by the International Astronomical Union. And he said to me, he said, yes, it's quite exciting, isn't it? I had one named after me many years ago. So I had the great delight of being able to send him an email shortly after that. And I said, I got a hold of the International Astronomical Union, and I asked them what the size of your asteroid is. And they said, oh, about 100 miles on each side. I want to tell you, Arthur, that my asteroid is 140 on each side. That my asteroid is bigger than your asteroid. I don't know whether he took that well or not. Come to think of it, I never heard from him again. No, that's not true. I lied. Now, ladies and gentlemen, many of you will be wondering, who are not familiar already with my work, what is my expertise? I am not a scientist. I try to be a teacher in my own way, in my amateur way. I am a magician by trade. That is to say, more correctly, a conjurer. Someone who approximates the effect that a magician would be able to perform, because a magician, by definition, would be someone who subverts nature, who changes the laws of the universe and makes things work differently from the way they usually do. Now, as a magician, as a conjurer, more correctly, as a magician, I do this for purposes of entertainment only. And one thing I know about my art as a magician, I know that people make assumptions. That is to say, if I give them some sort of suggestion as a magician on stage, I give them a suggestion, and if I do it properly and pleasantly enough, they will tend to follow that suggestion. They will accept what I suggest to them. Now, you'll never, as a magician, walk on stage and say, I have here an ordinary deck of cards. You never say that, because that gives the audience the idea, oh, I never thought of that. Maybe that's not an ordinary deck of cards. So you never give them that suggestion. You just allow them to assume that it's an ordinary deck of cards. Now, we all make assumptions. Oh, I can imagine some people sitting here saying, not me, I don't make assumptions. No, not me. Well, if you didn't make some assumptions, you would be catatonic. You would freeze up. Now, traffic lights, for example. I travel all over the world, as I said, and I can tell you that red means stop, and green means go, and amber means go right hell. That's the rules of the road. The rules of the road are something that you can pretty well depend upon, but we make a lot of other assumptions. For example, now, many, many people say, oh, I got to look at James Randi, and he looks like a regular fellow, has a beautiful beard, he's a handsome chap, and has a nice tie, and a few things like that. But then if you ask him, does he wear glasses? Oh, yes, he wears glasses. No, I don't. These are not glasses. These are just empty frames. The glasses are actually here in my pocket someplace, embedded in my chest. And I now will put them on, and for the first time, I will see you as an artist.
They're ugly.
I'm so surprised. Now, you made the assumption, because I walked out here with a pair of frames on my face, that there were lenses in the frame. And that's an ordinary assumption. That's a regular, expected assumption. But you would be wrong if you went home and said that he wore glasses. Until later on in the lecture, at this point, you see. But there are other assumptions that you've made as well. For example, you think that this is a microphone. It is not. It is a beard trimmer. But you see, you made that automatic assumption too, and I will move the microphone around onto my tie, and you'll hear me much better. This is a little clearer, it is muffled by the tie. But I use these two little tricks to show you that you too can make innocent assumptions, and you will do it if you're given the chance. Now, at the James Randi Educational Foundation, we fight astrology, speaking to the dead, prophecy, from stock market all the way to hockey scores, curing illnesses, giving advice on critical matters, tarot cards to crystal balls, the whole thing, love and marriage, anything whatsoever. We give advice on these things, and the advice is very simple. It's all nonsense, fraud, information. It's a fake. Now, one thing that I want to discuss with you in detail, because I think it's very, very important, is the matter of homeopathy. Now, I'd like to see a hands, if someone here has a brief definition, just a sentence or so, on what homeopathy really is. Can I see some hands?
Person right back, yes, please.
Well, it's the principle that the more you dilute a medicine into a pill or some liquid, yes, the more effective it is.
All right, the gentleman said that the more that you dilute a medicine down, into the form of a pill or another liquid, the more effective it is. Well, that's generally the idea, yes. But I'm going to do an experiment right now. I have, where is the bottle of sleeping pill?